My name's Karen Jones. Thank you all for being here tonight. I just wanted to say thank you. A little bit about the Civics Club. Tanya and I, about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, got together chatting and how disappointed we were in the low voter turnout in Elgin. With the local elections, with the school boards, and with the city council elections. And so we just kind of brainstormed the idea, came up with this idea of nonpartisan. Both of those elections are nonpartisan, so that makes it really easy. We didn't want to get into party politics, and with the local elections, that's very easy to do. And how we can go out. So what we do is just a lot of the things that the candidates do, going door to door, saying, hey, there's an election coming up. We want to get people engaged, educated, informed, and get them out voting. So we established a group last year in 2014. There's quite a few here. If you guys want to stand up, the ones that participated last year with the club. And we were really pleased. They did a lot of the door-to-door stuff, and we had meetings during the election season and brainstorming, getting ideas, lots of great ideas from a lot of different folks. So it was a fun thing to do. So tonight, thank you guys all for being here. Tanya's gonna go through a little bit of a rundown. Thank you, City Manager Stegall, for being here as our guest speaker tonight. And we'll get started.
Okay. Thanks, Karen. Hi, everybody. For those who don't know me, I'm Tanya Hudson, and I am one of the founding members of Elgin Civics Club. During my day job, I work at Advocate Sherman Hospital as the Director of Public Affairs and Marketing, and I am a lifelong Elgin resident. I'm very passionate about what the club is doing. So I'm going to take just a few minutes to go through a couple slides on who the club is, what we've done, that type of thing. So first we're going to start out with some numbers. 42,654. Any guesses?
Registered voters in Elgin.
So good. We don't have any prizes, but if we have one, we have a new one. Yes, number of registered voters in Elgin, 5,854. Yeah. In the last election, in the 2015 election, 5,854 ballots cast. That's a 13% turnout. So I didn't want to make you have to do the math. So 13% turnout in Elgin in the last election. So the number that's not on here is about 37,000 people, registered voters, who did not cast ballots in the last election. And the Elgin Civics Club wanted to know why. And so as Karen mentioned, we did a lot of things throughout the past couple months. I'm going to share a few of those with you in just a few minutes. So first of all, this is kind of just brass tacks, our vision of what we're trying to do in Elgin. We're trying to capture the minds and hearts of Elgin residents, informed and engaged residents in Elgin. And the reason for that is because we think informed and engaged residents creates good government, good city government in Elgin. That means more people, diversity in the broadest sense of the word, of opinions, ideas, more people who are involved in the decisions and the discussions about the services that the city provides and the amount that we are as residents willing to pay for those services. And we feel that 5,854 people is great, but what about those 37,000 others that did not voice their opinions in an official way by casting votes in the election? So informed and engaged residents not only creates good government, but that then creates good schools, which is so important to creating strong and stable communities. I don't know about you, but I want to live in a strong and stable community, especially if you're a property owner, right? The assets and all those things you're investing in our community, strong and stable communities make those assets that much more valuable. So the way that Elgin Civics Club has defined good government, it's inclusive. So we want to include those 37,000 people, and we need to find ways to include them. Figure out the things that are important to them. Good government is accountable. Staff, elected officials, residents, we're accountable, all of us together, for making good decisions about our community. Good government is innovative. And some of the stuff you're going to hear tonight from City Manager Stegall, we got this. Innovative. Elgin is definitely innovative, and it's something to be really proud of. future-oriented and collaborative. So very important that residents, elected officials, staff, we all work together, we all collaborate to get to where we need to be, and we're focused on the future. We're not just solely concerned about the problems of today, we're future-oriented. So this is our game plan. It's very simple. We like pictures at Elgin Civics Club. So we want to educate, we want to engage, and then we want to act. And in order, the results of that are informed voters. So notice here that we don't say just voter turnout. It's not just about the numbers. It's about, yes, more is better, higher numbers, but that those votes that are cast, those ballots that are cast by informed voters, and we feel a responsibility of the club to be sure that we help with that. And then we'll all be holding hands like that, walking down the street, right?
Singing Kumbaya.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So what we've done so far, we've been focusing a lot on the educate portion of that game plan. So how many of you have visited the website, elginciviksclub.com? Great. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all those things. Just, again, the way that we communicate in this day and age, we really wanted to get those social tools out there. You'll see some of our members up here in some of the pictures. So a few of our members were on Left, Right, and You, that show on WRMN. A couple of us went into Elgin High civics classes and educated high school students and got their feedback on what they think about politics, and that was really interesting. We did meet the candidates on our website, where we, in an unbiased fashion, we put all the information out there about every candidate that was running for city council and gave them that opportunity to put their own words out there in an unbiased way. We kind of want to make it a one-stop shop for people to get local election information. And then in the engage part of our game plan, other people and members that are part of our group, one of the big things we did was called Walk the Vote. And what that was is we looked at all the precincts in the city of Elgin that have high registered voters but low voter turnout. And we walked those precincts. We went door to door, we knocked on doors, and we wanted to know why. And we engaged those residents and got some great information that we're using in the future. And we also did a rock concert because we thought it would be cool. So at Next Door Theater, we did Rock the Vote. And we were trying to engage younger people and get them interested to register to vote online, because that's sort of a new thing that's out there. You can register to vote online. That's a lot more appealing to young people than having to go stand in line, register, all that. So we were promoting online registration. So what's next for the club? The community dialogue series, that's the first of what we're doing tonight. And so thank you so much for joining us on this first of the series. Next month, we're hoping to have Tony Sanders, the superintendent of U86, because as you noticed, when we went back, good government, good schools, strong, stable community, so we want to have all those civic leaders involved. Civics 101 in local schools. So you saw a picture of a couple of us that were in Elgin High Civics Club. We were invited to be in a fourth grade classroom at Creekside, actually all fourth graders at Creekside Elementary School, in 2 weeks to talk to them about local government. Isn't that cool? I can't wait. They're going to be so fun. And then we're doing voter registration events. So soon we'll team up with other agencies in our community and try to, again, just raise the awareness about voter registration. Any questions about Elgin Civics Club for me or any of the members that are here before we move on to our guest speaker?
Do you get funding from anybody, or you just fund yourself?
Are you offering?
Absolutely not.
You know, we have a GoFundMe site, and we just ask for individual donations, anybody that is willing to fund us and support us. So that's how we're raising money now. Yeah, and it's hard.
Sure is.
Any other questions? All right. I'm going to turn it over to our guest speaker, City Manager Sean Stegall. I'm sure many of you are already aware of who he is, but he has been in the city of Elgin for 15 years. I'm making him older than he is. And has been city manager for 11?
Feels like 50.
Yeah. 11.
And no, 2009.
Six. Yeah. 6.
Yeah, I was
well, your bio was wrong then that I found on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
So we're so fortunate to have just such a highly educated, highly experienced leader of the City of Elgin as an organization. So thank you, Sean, for being here tonight, and I will pull up your presentation.
Well, it's an honor to be here this evening. How appropriate that we're having this conversation in the library, which is a center in all cities, a focus of community participation. And it's really heartfelt, very exciting to see a group of people as the Civics Club that has come together solely for the purpose of good government. And when the Civics Club, you know, first started getting going, and there was stuff on Facebook, and I had several of my bosses, several city council members of the community, you know, everyone was trying to figure out, you know, what this was all about. But what was very interesting is that people were trying to figure out, were they Democrat or Republican, liberal or conservative? Because no group of people would just come together just for the purpose of good government, right? People don't do that anymore. And so that was just unbelievable to people. And I'm sure that there are still some people, maybe even some people here, that still don't buy that. And there's good reason if people don't buy that, because as I'm going to show you here this evening, all of the data and trends suggest that people don't do that. And that's part of the problem. So my message here tonight is, you know, this is my dear letter. I'm begging. We need you. Not the city of Elgin, although the city of Elgin does. But America, society needs a generation of leaders to replace the baby boomers and beyond who have built this country and have seen it through a lot of very difficult times. And when you look around, less people are voting. We have the hardest time finding people to serve on boards and commissions, and we have a very difficult time getting citizen input and engagement. And that's for a lot of reasons, and it's not an Elgin phenomenon. It is a societal issue. And I think to begin, if I could find one way to describe some of these disappointing trends that are occurring in the country, I think it can be summed up right here. Well, maybe not. Like I said, here.
Spaceball?
Pointed at the camera in the ceiling.
Thank you, Rich.
Only thing that works.
Sadly, I'm going to be talking a lot about technology this evening and trying to demonstrate how adept we are with it, but yet I can't get my presentation to work. There we go. Yeah, this was funny, if you've done right. But Kanye West was named by Time Magazine as the most influential person in America. Okay. So he joins great companies such as Neil Armstrong, John F. Kennedy, and others as being named by Time Magazine, which is obviously a very well-known, used to be very well-respected periodical in this country about who are influential. And the fact that Kanye West is deemed to be the most influential person in America, I think it tells you a lot about some larger issues that are going on and what influences people, where people are spending their time, and what people find important.
Who is Kanye West?
Well, let me describe it. Okay. I'm glad you asked, Chuck.
He's very
Yes. So, Kanye West is a musician. And if you would ask Mr. West, he would tell you he's the most brilliant man in the world.
Oh, yes.
Not known for his humility.
Yes.
But for those of you who know who Kanye West is, I'm assuming that since you are here, he's not the most influential person in your life. Okay. And he is a rapper, R&B guy. Okay. He's an entertainer, Chuck. Okay. And so regardless of the type or whether you like him or not, I think we could all agree that that has some meaning. Which button am I supposed to press? Spacebar?
Spacebar,
okay. So there's a lot of things that are influencing Americans now. We've become an entertainment society. Entertainment and politics have become one in one. Donald Trump, his success early on has been ascribed by many experts as being a combination of being an entertainer and a politician. And so the fact that that is found to be interesting or seen as refreshing, regardless of political affiliation again, is a very interesting commentary on the state of affairs. Whether he is, got good ideas or not, he does not have a long and distinguished career of serving the public. He served Donald Trump. And he is now, as you are all very aware, doing well in the Republican kind of horse race. So this idea is elected officials as entertainers. I don't know about you, I find that to be a disturbing trend. I like elected officials to be those that are being interested in governance. That's why I enjoy working for them, because I believe in the good, what they're doing, and don't like that other stuff as much. Uncivil engagement, sound bites versus ideas. I was reading an article in the New York Times from January. The name of it, January 18, 2015, is called Hating Good Government, New York Times. And in the last paragraph, I thought was very instructive. We're living in a political area in which facts don't matter. This doesn't mean that those of us who care about evidence should stop seeking it out, but we should be realistic in our expectations and not expect even most decisive evidence to make much difference. And the willingness for people to hold on to their beliefs in spite of all the evidence to the contrary. The fact that compromise is seen as weakness, that's a newer phenomenon. It really is in stark contrast to the fact, if some of you recall, when Senator Ted Kennedy passed away, the individual that was inconsolable at his funeral was Mormon Orrin Hatch from Utah. Okay? They were that close. Complete opposites of the political spectrum. But they work together in different ways for the good of the country. There isn't a lot of evidence that we're going to see that more in the future, okay? Unless individuals, civic-minded, good government types of citizens, such as everyone that's here this evening, continue to try to reverse this trend. Our once trusted institutions are at a crossroads, whether it is Enron, the accounting firm. So there's a complete lack of faith and trust in leadership. It's not just government. There's a complete lack of faith in institutions. And one comment that I read was that the only way not to be disappointed in institutions is just to assume they're going to fail and you set your expectations so low. So trust has been abused from leadership in this country in many different aspects, and there's much more attention to focus on it, which leads to apathy. One trend we'll be talking about here this evening is government. As a matter of fact, I appreciate the willingness of all you to spend the next 4 hours with me. So that's quite a commitment. Government as a facilitator versus a provider. The era of local government, is what I'm referring to specifically, as being a direct provider of services is coming to an end. The fact of the matter is the citizens are either unwilling or able, or a combination of two, to pay for those services. And there is not the solutions that government can craft without the assistance, real, tangible, substantive assistance, like many of you in this room have provided for quite some time, is to provide those local government services. So this idea of working with the community will move for local governments, will move from kind of speeches and brochures and newsletters into actual projects that occur on a regular basis. And certainly there's been a lot of those in Elgin. Many of you worked on those, but that will become the model. The idea of, for police department, we have a commander and a chief here this evening, the idea of neighborhood watches being seen as a really nice thing to have, and they are. The idea that neighborhood watches will morph into something much more where they are working side by side with the police department in preventative measures, a much more advanced role, because the ability for local governments to continue to add police officers is diminishing. Okay. Here's a chart, and this will stay depressing for only like the first 75%. Okay. But these are the facts. I mean, this is the reason why you're here and the reason that the Elgin Civics Club is so important. Look at this from 1974 to 1994. The date is a little dated, but we know it hasn't gone the other direction. Just the change during that time on how people got involved in their community, or acted in a way to kind of better government. And 42% serving as an officer of a club or organization dropped during that time, okay? And again, the people that came before, if you think about it, those that fought World War I, World War II, they put their life on the line to preserve liberty, okay? And so after having that victory, they certainly weren't going to not take advantage of the thing they put their life on the line for. So there was very real sacrifice that led to wanting to engage and serve and better your country by bettering your local government, by bettering your community. I'm a member of Generation X. We have there's certainly the Iraq War and some of those, but the country's existence has not been on the line. There hasn't been a galvanizing issue to bring Generation X or certainly the millennials together, and that creates a different mindset. So that's another kind of trend that is occurring here. It's a shrinking pie. Part of my job as city manager, part of the job of the city council members who are here this evening, part of your job is to continue to work and have conversations around sacrifice and less about splitting up the pie. Because whether we realize it or not, from the decades from 1950 all the way up to the Great Recession, we were dividing up a never-growing pie. Never felt like it was growing. I remember when we had $30 million a year in riverboat money, and we were all bummed out that we didn't have 40. And if we had 40, you'd want 50. Because there is never an end to the great things that you can do to move a community forward. But the reality of it, going back, is the resources are stagnating and or shrinking in many respects. And so the conversations now have to be about shared sacrifice and helping have the skills to help people deal with that sense of loss in many respects. So, dear Elgin Civics Club, do for local government what Mad Men did for TV, fashion, all things retro. Make good government cool. It really is cool. I mean, I think my job is, like, really cool. Okay. Every day, I truly feel honored and blessed to be able to go to Elgin City Hall and work on the things I'm working on with amazing people in the community, such as yourself, and at City Hall. And it really can be. And I know that's part of it. I like the approach that Civics Club is taking, making it something that can get people excited about getting involved in their community. Let's solve the problem before it exists in Elgin. Elgin obviously still has a decent amount of community involvement. It's not what it used to be. There's a lot of indicators, again, that would demonstrate that, but we can kind of re-energize that through the efforts of the Civics Club. Good government is cool, and it shouldn't be taken for granted. Civic engagement is important. And communities need to be more than chat rooms, instant messages, and I think I spelled emojis right. Okay. I know they call these things communities. As a matter of fact, at City Hall, and Dan and Laura can attest to this, some of the software programs that we're using, they call their groups that we set up, groups of citizens. These are some programs that we're working on in the future. They call those communities. And every time someone calls that a community, they have to put a dot, they have to give me a dollar. Because those aren't communities. This is a community. What's the word we came up for as a replacement?
Marketplace.
Much more acceptable. And so this idea of engagement being through social media. Social media has an ability to connect people that wouldn't otherwise be connected. Social media likely made this meeting here tonight possible. But social media won't actually solve the problems. It's a way of connecting people. But you're not going to build a neighborhood playground on Facebook. You're not going to rehabilitate an old home through Twitter, okay? And so there needs to be a kind of a realistic, unvarnished view of what social media is and what it is not, okay? So the game plan for tonight, well, it'll be more on the problem, talk about promoting civic engagement, talk about civic engagement to change the world, and then some examples of what we're doing at the City of Elgin to try to stay ahead of that curve. Dan Miller, who I believe all of you, or most of you in the room know who's here tonight, asked me if I was going to reference Bowling Alone. And I hadn't had a chance to respond to Dan yet. But yes, Bowling Alone by Robert Putnam was kind of the seminal piece that really raised the level of awareness, I believe it was released in 2000, about this issue of how communities are falling apart, meaning the community fabric. And he actually coined a phrase that is, it's called social capital. And he made the argument that you have like capital, things, money, equipment, there's human capital, people, but then there is this idea of what he called social capital, and that connecting with people, whether it's through bowling or serving on a PTA, is a fundamental element of a successful community. And without it, your community would be bound to suffer. And the way he popularized this idea was the fact that bowling leagues, which were, you know, very big. You know, my dad was in a bowling league, and that was like a really cool thing to do. Well, I'm not in a bowling league. I don't know about anyone else here, but I, you know, Karen's in a bowling league. Yes. And so he used bowling as the metaphor by which to make his argument about the idea that nobody should bowl alone. Nobody should have lunch alone. This idea of communities kind of collapse. And then he gave suggestions on how they can be revived. What's interesting is when Putnam wrote this in 2000, you know, this whole social media internet thing wasn't around enough. I think it was just an idea that Al Gore had at that time to kind of get moving forward. Some of you will get that joke. So what's the issue? I'm not going to read all of these to you. But the idea of that you're starting to have widespread groupthink, that people weren't thinking independently, that people weren't having civil, engaged, knowledgeable conversations in their communities about important topics, important policy issues, was starting to really go away. I showed you the chart before about participation. Turnout in national elections, the high point was in the early 1960s. There's been a decline in public meeting attendance. You know, the city council meetings, you see the same group of, Joe and Armita and a couple others who come regardless of what's on the agenda. I mean, it's understandable when people show up when there's an item of interest, but for people like Joe and Armita, all of it's of interest because it's their community, okay? And it's always funny when we have agendas for city council meetings that are relatively light, lots of times we get comments back like, well, this is not a very important meeting, kind of not a very big agenda. And I'm thinking, yeah, why should we even have it? We should just all do it without that whole process. Is that some certainly have more substantive items than others, but for people like Joe and Armita, it's important to stay and remain engaged. And I really honor that. But the fact of the matter is, in the 1960s, there have been a lot more Joe and Armita's. A lot more. Some other organizations, the collective, you know, individualism has been on a great rise for quite some time. It has now reached a fever pitch to the point to where in the private sector and in government, this idea of splitting, that people want government services individualized. I've never called 911, so I don't want to pay for police and fire. My kids don't go to U46, so I shouldn't have to pay the taxes. Well, I hear them. But the fact of the matter is, the idea of a community is that everybody pitches in to help everybody else. And so, while you may not have a child in U46, you understand that you benefit from an educated society. And that while you may not call 911, at some point in your life you may, and that in order for these things to be financially sustainable and work, the model is based upon all of us feeling like we have a stake in those things that we don't personally need. That idea that you care about things that are just for other people. I mean, that's an amazing concept, isn't it? Is that, wow, I think it's important even though I don't use it. That concept has been watered down with the help of Kanye and Kim. So what Putnam said at this time, again, this is in 2000, he came up with these ideas through studying that it was urban sprawl. Certainly people are working more, again, this is 2000. And the biggest culprit of all was actually in his study, was television. People were spending so much time getting their interaction from TV and that they were stopping to engage. Now, I will admit, there are lots of times when I would rather watch TV than talk to somebody. But I don't make it a regular habit. Or the idea that people send text messages, it used to be emails, then it turned into text messages, when they're right down the hall from you, okay? And avoiding human interaction, and that, you know, that isn't communicating, that's sending an electronic message. And as we all know, there can be a lot of confusion that occurs and communication problems. But all those, in Putnam's mind, led to a decline in civic engagement. And if you're wondering why I keep walking around, I'm just a very nervous person, naturally, so it's what I do, okay? So there are some technical issues here. This idea of globalization has led to communities being commodities, okay? So in Providence is the subdivision, the city of Elgin's first most recent new development west of Randall Road. It's called Providence. It's Long Common and Route 20. And after the first couple phases had been built, myself, when I was the assistant city manager and a reporter from the Daily Herald, had this idea of trying to discover why people moved there. And as we started our kind of research project, which got ended prematurely when she left, we found out that over half the people we talked to didn't know they lived in Elgin. Listen, they bought a home not knowing what community they live in. Okay. So how does that happen? Well, they knew the name of the subdivision, and they knew every single one of them knew what school district they were in. Okay. And this idea of what community you're in a suburban mentality, and let's face it, Elgin is a city, but Elgin's got a lot of suburbs in it too. Okay. It's got urban and suburban characteristics. And by every definition, Providence would be a suburban development. Okay. And so what actual community you're in is a very much a secondary decision. As a matter of fact, there for quite some time, and I don't know if it's still occurring, this idea that of West Elgin. West Elgin's not a place. Okay. It's an idea in people's minds of where they live. So that just simply couldn't have been the case 30 years ago. There's just no chance that when Liz Marston bought her first home, that she didn't know where it was. Okay. It's an amazing concept. Mobility and sprawl, kind of the same thing, is that through globalization, people don't work for one company. This idea of the local company, Hoffer Plastics, the company that is in a community for decades and decades, and their employees work there their whole career, and they buy a house and they invest in the community and they contribute to United Way and they serve on the Boys and Girls Club board. People are moving all the time. They're changing jobs numerous times, and they're moving from community to community. So communities have become commodities, and that is why they don't care so much where they live, but they know what school district they're in, and they usually know the name of the development. I mean, the idea that neighborhoods that are built and marketed more as a place into above itself. And globalization makes all that happen. And so when you have people that aren't invested in communities because they're never there long enough, it makes it difficult to have successful communities. And all these have major implications then for how communities are governed. Decline of the middle class. Okay, again, that keeps me up at night. By every indicator possible, it has been the middle class that has been the underpinning of democracy, the underpinning of good government. And I don't know if you guys have noticed this, but over and over again, year in and year out, rich are getting richer and poor are getting poorer. In a very great way. And that's not good. And so that has very significant implications. For democracy. And the fact of the matter is, when people are working so much, they're trying to keep their head above water, it's very difficult to then reasonably tell people they should be involved in their community. I mean, and so with the middle class declining, that makes it more and more difficult. Some adaptive issues here, these are kind of human issues. Trust is at an all-time low. People have become more self-centered, or since I knew the media would be here, quote me as saying inward focused, Elena and Janelle. Sean said people are self-centered. I don't know. Not good. So let's use inward focus. But it's the same thing. People are selfish. I'll show you. And then there's less reciprocity. The idea that if you do one good act for some, if you do a good act for someone, they'll do one for you. That's kind of a common sense thing. And there's just less civility. The age of gotcha. People always have gotcha. And I tell people all the time at the City of Elgin, anytime anybody wants to look at every penny we've spent, they're more than welcome to. They're going to find all kinds of things in there they disagree with, but they won't find anything that they could say was a misuse of public funds. And there's a big difference. And this mixing and mashing of, someone you disagree with, they're doing something wrong. No, that's just called disagreement. And those worlds have collided, and it's become fun to try to take people down and destroy them. And social media has made that all much, much easier. And I would submit to you, it's kind of common, that's not a good thing. Trust, look at this. This is just from a couple years ago. After you get from military and small business, and police was at 53%, and that's a whole other Civics Club topic that Jeff can be featured on, that you guys are paying a lot of attention to, on the relationship between citizens and the police. That would likely be less than 53. It'd probably be today, probably somewhere 47 or 48, maybe a little lower. But after that, what you can tell is basically everybody trusts no one. So we don't trust Congress, we don't trust TV, we don't trust news on the internet, big business, organized labor, newspapers, criminal. There's just trust gone from obviously military and small business. So it's easy to understand why people trust the military. Frankly, the fact that that's only 74% is kind of interesting. It could be higher. And everybody trusts, you know, the local donut shop, okay? So, because that's, you know, somebody that they know. Trusting government, it's always interesting, year in and year out. Out of every dollar, people believe that the federal government wastes 51 cents of them. State is 42 cents, I bet in Illinois would be a lot higher. But local government, you know, is at 37 cents. So although it's kind of weird being happy, I guess we compare favorably. But year, you know, by and large, people see their local government as being more fiscally responsible than the other forms, and you know, that's not really a compliment when you're, especially here, to be compared to state of Illinois. It's pretty easy. This is only the outcome. But when it comes to being satisfied with your city, and these are based on local survey results, you can see that people that are in Fort Collins, Little Colorado, 95% of them are very satisfied. What you'll also see here too on this list, the more homogeneous a community, the less diverse a community, the likelihood that satisfaction will be high. Kind of makes sense because everyone's the same. So your city services and your community is it's relatively easier to make a decision on what type of services and how you should connect with your community, because more than often than not, you're dealing with people that are very similar. Well, in Elgin, we have rich, middle class, poor, we're urban, we're suburban, we even have some rural elements. It's much more difficult in a city, if you will, to get that kind of commonality that you're looking for in certain areas. And here's dissatisfaction. Throughout the whole country, these were the most dissatisfied. And what's telling here is that at 72.8%, unfortunately Rockford was the lowest, but it was still 73% of the citizens of Rockford were satisfied. And that was the lowest in the country. So by and large, people are still very satisfied with their local government. Although these numbers will go down as engagement continues to go down. Self-centered, this idea, man is called selfish not for pursuing his own good, but for neglecting his neighbors. This idea of being a good neighbor. At the city of Elgin, you'd be amazed on how often we'll get phone calls, people want to call in confidentially, about their neighbor, sometimes their next door neighbor, who they will admit they have a good relationship with, but they want to tell us that their trash is out or they're parking in front of their house. And whether it's 311 or anyone else, our first question always is, well, did you talk to them about it? Well, no. Okay. Well, I can tell you, neighborhood problems are never going to be best solved by government. And that's not a conservative Republican statement. That's just based on facts. Is that people, neighbors, together solve their problems best first, okay? So neighborhood watch, because you're there every day, will always be better than someone patrolling a couple times a day. Just common sense. And so we always encourage people, unless you're in a difficult relationship or you feel threatened in some way, why have us go talk? When I first moved in Elgin, I lived in a townhouse. And I thought I had a really good relationship with my next door neighbor, really great guy. And one day, you know, it was probably like a really good city council meeting or something. I came home, I turned my stereo up, probably had a refreshment or two. And all of a sudden, Elgin police knocking on my door. Yeah. And said, what is it? And I can't remember who it was. They said, we got a call about your music's up too loud. Could you turn it down? I'm in a townhouse. My door's here, and his door's there. And someone I talked to every day, he called the police instead of just, I was the jerk, it was way too loud. I don't know what it was, but I wasn't thinking. That happens a lot with me. And so we turned it down, but that's a good kind of a personal example of the phenomenon that I'm talking about. Again, not good. A sociology journal did a study, and I'll give you all the details you can get from me after the meeting if you want. But from 1800 to 2000, by looking at words, specific keywords used in publications, thousands and thousands and thousands of books, which only technology could do now. They looked at the word give versus get, and what you notice is that this idea of getting things versus giving things has had an inverse pattern. So the idea of giving back was much more prominent than this idea of, you know, self-fulfillment and self-awareness and all those great things should always come first versus kind of being more of a collective. And I have nothing against self-awareness and self-fulfillment, but this idea of balance, and you can see, look at the steep incline, you know, from that would be like 1980 to 2000. Again, it's Kanye's fault. Recent, this survey is from 2014. When asked what's more important, U.S. contrast with Europe, having nobody in need, meaning there's no human being in need, or freedom to pursue your life goals, 58% of us thought, yeah, freedom for me is more important than having nobody in need. And direct look at Europe. Okay. I will officially say Europe's ahead of us on this one. I, you know, to me, that's a pretty cool concept. This one is just terrifying. This one was asked last year. Now, this is unscientific, but they did talk to 200-some-thousand people and asked, what would you rather do, get a life-changing amount of money in the lottery or have prevented World War II? 65% of people would have chosen to get money instead of preventing World War II. That's sad. You know, that is a very, very disturbing. Everybody know what this is? Stop sign. You know what this is? The percentage of people that admitted intentionally blowing completely through a stop sign at least once a year. So 1979 was about 30%. Look where it was by 99. Almost 100% of people admitted that they intentionally just ran through a stop sign. So I think this is a great indicator. This is kind of the stop sign indicator. And I'll tell you, you don't need to be a police officer to know that completely just blowing through a stop sign is a perfect indicator of selfishness. It's like, I'm going to get to where I'm going no matter what. And if they're a police officer, we all understand they can do rolling stops. Everyone knows cops don't have to stop themselves. Right, Jeff? Yeah, that's a joke. You can laugh. But rolling stop or full stop and no stop at all. Actually, that's a great concern to Jeff. He talks about that a lot. So we're going to put these up pretty here real soon, just to make sure in Elgin we're not having this problem. This idea of civic engagement, like anything else, there are always two sides to the story. And I've read this book. I won't give you my opinion of it. But you can make a great, it's about in defense of selfishness. And so if you want to check that out, I'm sure they have it somewhere. Okay, now switching gears a little bit. Let me get a drink of water. I only have like 250 more slides left. Civic engagement means working to make a difference in the civic life of our communities and developing the combination of knowledge, skills, and values and motivation to make that difference. It means promoting the quality of life in the community, both through political and non-political processes. And it's good for you. So for those of us that are still interested more in maybe the self-fulfillment, the well-being index, which I'm not going to describe here, Karen Jones offered to after the meeting, she'll tell you all about it. If you have received community service recognition, your well-being index score is 70% versus those people that haven't received any recognition. And to get recognition, you actually have to serve, right? It was only 58%. And so there's another indicator. There's correlation between giving back to your community and being actually healthier. Some outcomes that have been found with communities with strong civic engagement. It's more, government's more effective and more innovative. I know a lot of people that work for the city of Boulder, Colorado, and they love their job, very innovative community. They're doing some amazing things there. But everything takes twice as long as it does at the city of Elgin. And for those of you who don't live with us, that's a long time. It takes twice as long as us. Because the community is involved in literally every step along the way. So, in most local governments, certainly the city of Elgin, you pay good money, pay good tax dollars to have experts. But in Boulder, the mentality is that while they may be the experts or doing the work, there's going to be checks and balances and input along every step. And I don't know if those of you have been to Boulder, but it's a pretty cool place to live. Okay. And so when you talk to the city staff from Boulder, understandably, they often get exhausted with the civic and engagement and involvement thing, as you can might imagine. But like what I said to them is, but look at the results of Boulder and the fact that Boulder would not allow there to be this complete political upheaval because people that live in Boulder have decided this is what we want out of the community, this is who we are, and that will remain consistent and has remained consistent for decades and decades and decades because the community is involved to such a high degree. So that's where, because they demand effective and more innovative. less crime, less poverty, more employment, better, more sustainable policies, more frequent resident cooperation. Greater levels of trust in local government, increased support for community-wide solutions, elected and by elected officials. This third one's really of interest to me. Really, re-election of council members, it's always a good thing. And collective self-restraint in the face of community need. And so some of the data that they showed, again, I'm not gonna read all of it, but basically, they used five different categories, but the more involved the community, and also the more affluent the community, the more success that they had in all those different areas. So some of the outcomes, people voted more often. What was interesting though is that the more often meeting attendance had a positive relationship with the community ratings, but the more people went to meetings, they would rate the government lower. And so I guess actually watching it up close, it's not as much fun. And so I thought that was thought that was it. Watching meetings had negative relationships except for on the idea of sense of community. And my guess there, that is it's, again, the discourse can often be pretty tough. So city engagement in a challenged world, here's the internet adoption. Basically everybody is using the internet. There are still some people that don't. My dad still refers to my phone as an email machine, even though he never used email before. So there are still some, but not many. Millennials and baby boomers, there's a generational divide on how they get their news. The baby boomers still, more often than not, will read newspapers, get their information on local TV. Millennials, not so much. And if you notice, Generation X, again, I mentioned earlier, this is my generation, is really the forgotten generation because we're like half baby boomer, half millennial, and so no one talks about us. We're like Jan on Brady Bunch, the middle child, who's always complaining, Jan. So I'm complaining because like there's no, you can't find like any studies on Generation X people anymore. It's like we don't count because we're like, we stand for nothing, I guess. So we're not cool like millennials, like Dan Lowe are so cool. And you know, we're not wise like Bill Briscoe. And so we got the Generation X. You guys form a subcommittee, like the defense of Generation X, I'm all about. All right. Millennials are less interested in politics than older generations, talk about it less than baby boomers. Again, this is why you guys need to make it cool. And say politics and government is a top three interest. You know, for millennials, it's 26%. There's a little Generation X data there. You see, we're like right in the middle. Okay, switching gears a little bit. This is just a sampling of the technology, internet, cloud, whatever you want to call it, based companies that have formed just recently in the last couple years to revitalize, to transform, and to fundamentally change the way local governments conduct their business. And the way that they're all being changed is in a way to connect with citizens on a very personal level. And again, there's some good outcomes to that. Then the bad ones is, you know, personal is the opposite of community. We're using some of these. We're using BasicGov and Salesforce, and they do a lot of different things. Some of them work in the private sector as well. But for the most part, 10 years ago, none of these companies existed. And I'll give you some examples. So this is an example that comes from Oakland, a real-life example just from last year from the police department. They're having some robberies in Oakland. I would have used Elgin, but we don't have those anymore. And so the traditional way to deal with robberies is, gun, whether that's a private or personal. You might have a dog, you might have neighborhood watch, but what they did in Oakland in this neighborhood, because the city of Oakland is so stressed for financial resources, they did a group funding, crowdsourcing, a lot of different terms, to fund it themselves. And so, using social media, they immediately started raising money to give to the police department to provide for more police services for their neighborhood. And again, that's that phenomenon I'm talking about, because local government resources are spread so thin that in Oakland, which is having very significant problems, they were using social media to raise money for that. Social media uses for 2014, everybody knows, everyone, it's big. The media, this idea of media is now consumer control, okay, and this idea of professional journalism, you know, I didn't realize how important professional journalism was until it got cut in half. I didn't realize how great these Sunday editorials from the Baileys were, the ones that used to hit city staff up, you know, something bad happened, like everything went all crazy, you know, city council members are calling. I would do anything to go back to that day when people got their information, the facts from a newspaper. I mean, I have become, you know you're getting old when you talk about the good old days. Older, and not too old. That, you know, this idea of having professional journalism with standards versus this idea now that is out there, that it's about getting it out there first, and then you can fix it later. And the pressure, you know, Elena and Janelle are here, to get information out, and then you got city managers that are trying to get it to their elected officials before they read it on Facebook, is immense, and it's impossible. Information is so fluid and is so everywhere, there is no way to control it. And there's good to that and there's bad to that. The good to that is, it's impossible to keep a secret. It's impossible. Conspiracy theorists really don't have much to do anymore, because in order to have a conspiracy, you have to have secrecy. And it's impossible to have secrecy in an age of media being everywhere. The bad side of that is that it's very easy for those that may be irresponsible to educate the community or communities in a way that may serve their own interests without having to do what professional journalists have to do. And that's meet what are called standards. Government transparency has really changed a lot. You know, before it would be about demonstrating where the money you took in and the money you went out and responding to these things. Well, government transparency now can also be this PolitiWhoops. This is a site that's dedicated to posting deleted tweets by elected officials. Yeah. And again, while it's really fun to read that, it might be entertaining, but it doesn't mean it's good. You know, a lot of the things that we find entertaining don't mean that they're good. And, you know, elected officials are like nobody else, are no different than anyone else. We all say things that we regret, except when elected officials do it, there are consequences. And the consequences often that the public puts on elected officials are not the ones that they would want to have to endure. And so I always like to remind people is that elected officials are human beings too, and so they make mistakes, we all do. And having these sites dedicated to it, sign of the times. Here's some more crowdfunding. Kansas City, Texarkana, Detroit, where citizens are getting together and they're collecting money for projects that they want done. And again, I know I said it 50 times already, but that will become more and more prevalent. The Friends of Lord's Park, one of the first acts when I became city manager, and that's what I'm proud of, where the first decision I had to make was to close the petting zoo in the zoo, which was a really popular decision with my two-year-old daughter at the time, who we lived right by Lord's Park, who went there every weekend. She was really proud of daddy. But it was something we had to do. Well, to the credit of Friends of Lord's Park, they have taken it on themselves to provide not only most of the labor, but most of the resources, which we have then matched to get that thing going again. And I think it's a really excellent story and example of what's going to have to be done more and more. You know, getting things fixed, we have if you haven't used it yet, a really great mobile app, one that we believe is really innovative and does a lot of things that others don't. Dan, all of them, Laura Valdez are here. They can tell you all about it because it's their product of their work.
Sean, yes. I've used that, mm-hmm. I needed somebody to pass, and I thought I'd call the city and see what they did. She looked it up for me and found me somebody, and they were excellent.
That's like the stories we like. That's good. I'll give you $5 after the president. I appreciate that. We're getting examples more and more. We had somebody send an email a couple days ago who they were traveling on Randall Road and thought they checked the mobile app to see what traffic was like. They'd never done it before, and they were able to successfully avoid a big traffic jam and construction issue, and it saved them a lot of time. And so this will be getting used more and more and more. But we're part of a trend. You know, people are using Twitter to communicate. There's a software program called TexasEnd that allows local governments to text all of their constituents. Informing Citizens, an example from another community. However, we demand too much from technology, not enough of ourselves. Okay, again, the technology gives you the ability to complete transactions. It doesn't give you the knowledge or the ability to actually do them. And so there, you could have a smartphone and just use it as a phone. And you can have all the technology in the world. And so we got to make sure we're not seeing technology as the end result, but as a means of getting to an end result. Okay. So Facebook makes it possible to get the word out about the Civics Club. Facebook's not going to do the work of the Civics Club. Okay. So much said, in a very wise move, Sherry Turkle thought, you know what, that Putnam guy's book, Bowling Alone, was written in 2000. She did kind of an update to it that Putnam didn't endorse, because that means he didn't get paid enough, called Alone Together, and this idea of social media, we're together, but yet we're alone. You have friends on Facebook, people you've never met. I have so many more friends on Facebook than I ever had in real life. And, you know, the key to them wanting to be my friend is they've never met me. So again, these ideas, the limitations, how much more time do I have? I'm over, right?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay. When polled about how effective some of these means are in dealing with local elected officials or getting something done in your community, you'll notice that overwhelmingly, citizens said attending meetings with an elected official, calling an elected official, sending an email to an elected official, we replace that in Elgin with 311. Send a message are far more effective than writing a letter to the editor. Spreading the word on Facebook or Twitter, okay, that's, you know, one of my pet peeves is hearing about an alleged problem on Facebook. Well, it doesn't actually mean it's a problem. Right? And an interesting phenomenon was a couple weeks ago, there was this parking issue next to a fire hydrant. And because of a combination, you know, that overused term, a perfect storm, because of the desire by some to have to be about attention and not actually solving the problem, and then people demanding a solution instantly. So I was being asked what we're going to do about it when I literally hadn't had a chance to even look at it. But yet, you understand, I haven't looked at it yet, or I haven't talked to anyone about it. Yeah, but what are we going to do? People on Facebook want to know what we're going to do. How about we get one day? How about the city of Elgin gets one day to look at it? We didn't get a day. So it's on Facebook, there's pressure on the Daily Herald and the Courier News to put something out, and then the day after that, it's on, I think, CBS. It's on Saturday morning. And literally, this was a parking spot that was mislabeled. So the social media phenomenon actually working against logical, rational decision-making. That issue, I spent 8 hours talking to citizens, elected officials, and staff members about something that I didn't ever even get a chance to understand. And so for 8 hours, I was telling people basically, I don't know. And that's not acceptable because instant satisfaction, right? So face-to-face is still better. Peer-to-peer revolution, again, the idea of citizens working together. This one I think is very scary when it comes. There are just certain things that it's better off to have paid professionals work on. So, like, when I'm really sick, I don't think that I'll be able to make myself better. And I'm really reticent to believe that armed neighbors are better than trained professional police officers. And, you know, I'm familiar with the Trayvon Martin case, but more and more, these private security patrols, is that if we can't get what we need from the police department, or if we can't get, you know, what we want from the federal government, we're going to stand post at the border, we're going to walk around with a gun in my neighborhood, you know, there's a reason why professionals do it. So while this can be good when it comes to building a neighborhood park, you know, he's talking about potholes. I don't want Sean Stevens to fix an pothole. Okay. So that's a problem. I'll give you a little bit more information about ahead of the curve. This is a phrase we use in Elgin, what we're trying to do. This is a picture from after a flood where people had their basement flooded and they put their stuff on the curb. But because of our outdated technologies from 6 years ago, our code enforcement officers and the public safety people, the water department and the police that were helping people with their flooded basements, had no ability to know whether this was as a result of flooding or people just violated the code and put trash out. So people in a flooded area were all cited for putting trash on the curb. And it was a week after newly elected council members were sworn in. That I'll never forget. that. But the idea of the technology, so we were citing people who were being cited at the worst, most vulnerable moment. Obviously, but they didn't ever have to pay it. To now with 311, is that 311, people are like air traffic controllers, kind of guiding all of the different departments and making sure also through our technology that the left hand, the left hand knows what the right hand is doing. So where we're going, we want to make decisions that are more based on results. I'm going to pass through for some of these things. There's been a lot that's been written in some professional journals about the amount of money that we have been able to save by being more efficient, by using technology. But we want to combine, again, the use of our technology with a more human interaction. Again, it's not just about you have a need, we're going to serve it. We want to be able to use the technology to have conversations about how you can help solve your own problems and use us more as a facilitator than a direct provider of the service. And that is the trend that is occurring that will lead to more ownership in government. And frankly, it is the only model of government that will be able to be afforded in the future. So that's where we are going. We're building those systems. This idea of having these department silos. So the government on having, you have a police department, you have a fire department, you have a public works department, and they all kind of stay separate. You know, nobody would design a city like that today. If we were all to start the city of Elgin today, you wouldn't create all these artificial separations. As a matter of fact, we train city employees so they can be multifaceted and work in a variety of different areas, because the more cross-trained people are, you need less of them, okay? And so we have to unwind a lot of those institutions. The public was often confused. They didn't know who to call. As a matter of fact, before 311, there were almost 100 published phone numbers in the phone book to call. And frankly, I admit, I was a city manager, and there would be things that would happen when I was off work, and I didn't know who to call. I wasn't quite sure. Is this a meter shop, or is this the water department? And I'm thinking, well, I wish I could call the city, and then I remember I'm a city manager, so if I don't know, I got a problem. There's just a lot of confusion. And so the more winding the road, the more inefficient it is, the more expensive it is. And so dealing with 311, not only do you have a central point of contact for the citizens, but it also allows us to be the most efficient in the delivery of those services on our end. What a lot of communities do, they just take 311 and they layer it over an already inefficient system. And so the citizens, it's seamless to them, but it's still completely inefficient on the back end and very expensive. Well, we're doing that, as the intake to them, force the efficiencies and drive different results in the departments down below. Because we're not only interested in serving the citizens more effectively, but we want to serve them more efficiently, which means less cost. If you guys ever want, you should stop in. I do every once in a while in 311 and listen to some of the conversations and the feedback. And you hear a lot of them saying you're welcome a lot and several times. So that's always, the more you're welcomes I hear, the more I know that was a good interaction. We've had more than 100,000 requests to 311. And one of the neat things is a large percentage, over 60% of calls into 311 are simply just to get information. What time does the 4th of July parade start? And so it's not always solving a complex problem. Lots of times it is, sometimes it isn't. By going through 311 and using this type of technology, we're able to allow for a more consistent experience. There is nothing that's more frustrating for a city manager or chief of police or anybody when you're talking to a citizen and they're describing some interaction that they had with the city, and you can't give them a reason why it happened. Okay, that's never good, and so you want to avoid those. And by having more of a centralized approach, you're able to have a much higher level of quality control. I've talked about the mobile app. What we're doing differently, describe that than other mobile apps. Here's where we'll be using it, primarily. You see 35 to 44 is 80%, 25 to 34. That's overgeneralized. Typically, the younger you are, the more often that you'll use technology. Our app is available to 95% of home users. And here's all the different, I'm just speeding through this now. I'm basically just hitting the space bar. All the different functionalities and features that our mobile app has. So it's not just about submitting requests. You need information on there. You can find out. I checked the weather the other day on the mobile app. I don't use the mobile app a lot because well, I have lots of people around me that can are even better than mobile apps. But for everybody else, it's a really, it's a great tool. And so when you see sidewalks being repaired, you see trees that are dead, you see cable wires that are hanging, take a picture, use a mobile app, take a picture and send it in to us. You'll get a confirmation number, and at some point, you will see, depending on what it is, that it was resolved. Here's the process by which you do that. It's really slick. Anybody can do it. It's very, very simple, very user-friendly. So, to wrap up, it's the slide that I did earlier. Civics Club, thank you. I think what you're doing is really important work. I made the case for that. You can see that the challenge in front of me was daunting. You're basically being asked to reverse a global megatrend. But if there's anyone that can do it, it's you guys. You guys are up to it. And it doesn't take that many people. I get the difference of having, even if 30, 40, 50 people, Civics Club would grow, that makes a huge difference. You're welcome. Thank you. Let's solve the problem. Okay, so I'll tell you what, decisions will continue to get made. And the less involved the community is, the more those decisions will be made by a small group of people with a narrow focus. And so again, what I say to people, the fact that you're not involved doesn't mean nothing's happening. Stuff keeps happening. We still keep having city council meetings. We still keep spending tax dollars. And either they're your money. So either you're going to have some involvement in that or not. And we can demonstrate to you there's lots of facts that at local government, it's not a waste of your time. Okay, we do listen, we do act on those things. We don't always agree, which is, I can't stand it when people, when you disagree, they say you didn't listen. They're two different things. Just spread the word. Agreeing and listening. We always listen. We agree a lot. We don't always agree. But you can be involved and know that decisions will continue to be made that do impact you. And so I like to have some input into things that impact me. I'm sure I know everyone preaching to the choir here. Good government is very cool. Nonpartisan government is awesome. Seeing two people that disagree vigorously in a respectful way on a topic is what America is all about. And you can disagree without being disagreeable. And I understand a civics club is all about promoting those people regardless their policy positions aren't important. That's the whole point of it. It's not partisan. The whole point is that how you carry yourself, how you conduct yourself, how you get involved in your local government, in your community, is what is important. Civic engagement is important. We talked about all the data, showed all the data that this community will be more efficient, your health will go up, your health index, you'll be a healthier person, you'll be happier. Clearly, look how happy Jeff is. Jeff Sobota is like never unhappy. Because that's because he's every night he's at a community meeting, right? And if you go to a community meeting every night, you'll be as happy as Jeff. I mean, it's the best exhibit I could find. And again, communities need to be more than chat rooms, instant message emojis. So use social media, use technology like the city of Elgin is using it in a way to support the human interactions and engagement and working with our citizens. And there's a lot more we need to do in that area. You can never do enough, but we're definitely committed to it. And know the city council is committed to it. And I would encourage you, as you move forward, and some of your speakers, to ask city council members. I know there's two here that would obviously are very interested in the topic. They all are. And get involved. So thank you. Any questions? Did I answer questions?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
I do have a question. One is, I find it interesting that when the mayor speaks, I'm going to steal one of his lines because it's a great line. He said, when we're elected by the voters that we spoke about earlier, we don't only represent those voters, but we represent all citizens of Elgin. I like adding into the line, I challenge people, I say, remember that 50% of the people in Elgin can't vote. And I love when someone comes back and says, they're legal or this or that. I said, no, they're under the age of 18. They're children. And we represent them also and their concerns and their needs. And a lot of people forget that, when you look at parks and different things that we represent those who can't vote also. So that's, you know, something that wasn't really captured well in the numbers. You know, when you take a look, and when you're looking at numbers, I know you can't put everything up on a slide. But that's something that you
have
to remember too, that Sean does try, yes.
Yeah.
But that's something you have to remember also, is that a lot of people in this community are under the age of 18. And I'd say it's probably about 35%, I think, was the last number from the census. And don't hold me to it. I read it, but I believe that's about the number, correct number. The other thing I'd like to challenge the civics is we have a great group here, great location and stuff, but maybe coming to the Rockall Ranch or to one of the neighborhood associations, clubhouses, and the western side of the city of Elgin. It's not the far west area, but it's the area where I live, and I think trying to get those people a little bit more engaged to realize that, yes, you are in the city of Elgin. Yes, you are in a city, even though you're in a different school district, even though you're in different townships, even though you might not even be in the Gail Borden Library District, you are still a citizen of the city of Elgin and still represented by the Elgin City Council and its elected officials. While you're working to do that, I congratulate you and support you.
Any other questions? Chuck?
The first half of your presentation set me up to anticipate something. You know, you were very carefully constructing the demographic historic data to show that civic engagement is declining, going down since the span. And it was such a clear and purposeful focus. I felt you were going to offer at the conclusion or the end how to combat this trend, how to do something about it. But then all of a sudden you got into 311, Shelton government is doing some things, and I thought, well, wait, how is this combating the problem? And I feel that you must have some insights beyond saying Civics Club, this is great, keep it up. And can you offer something that you feel is an insight to how to actually correct the decline of civic engagement?
Well, I think first
you didn't. You set me up to expect that and hope for that, but
well,
it didn't happen.
I knew it was obvious, but it was, I didn't know it was that obvious on where I spent most of the time on my presentation. Yeah. The that was a joke, by the way. I have friends here, you know, when I say it's a joke, it's already embarrassing enough to have to point it out. You could then give me the courtesy laugh. Chuck, I think the point, which I obviously didn't make strong enough, and I agree, is that the solution is this. I mean, my presentation was to make the case and to affirm what you're doing, because a group like the Civics Club, again, all of the trends would say this group can't succeed. That it's got off to a nice start, but it won't succeed. And I understand the people that are in charge of it, you guys are all busy, right? I mean, you got other things to do, you have families, some are here. And that at the end of the day, the pressures of working, the pressures of apathy, all those different things will eventually consume the group. However, I know the people associated with it very well, and they don't give up easily. And so what I wanted to do first and foremost was send a message of just how important the work is that Elgin Civics Club is doing and how critical it is. And to talk about in using technology, and just an example on how we're engaging the community to try to get using the technology to try to make people feel more connected. But the Civics Club, which is, again, a throwback, kind of retro, a more traditional way of doing it, while the data suggests is that face-to-face interactions, promoting good government. So if a city council member were to say things at a city council meeting that a particular citizen doesn't like, but it's not about the topic, it's about how they did it, they should be talked to about that. Is that, hey, we expect more out of you. We expect, or a city manager. I mean, I've been known to say things, I shouldn't. And that type of, so feeling like you have ownership, that things aren't happening to you. And you're not a good, I mean, you're an example of the opposite, Chuck. Obviously, you're heavily involved in your community. And so, but there's a lot of people that, if encouraged in the right way, could get involved. And so the solution also, too, is for citizens to stop thinking it's happening to them by other people. So let's use Illinois. Mike Madigan. Mike Madigan's so powerful. It's ridiculous. This, you know what? He's not appointed by the king. He keeps getting elected. Okay. And so it's always interesting to hear citizens have these conversations about elected officials like they have no control over it. I mean, I'm yet to meet an elected official that I worked for that wasn't elected. You know what I mean? They don't just show up one day. I'm like, yeah, this dais looks cool. I like the big books with all that paper. So I think it's having ownership, and it's just taking it seriously and getting involved. But other than that, Chuck, there isn't anything else. There aren't any secrets. It's all right there. It's just a willingness and a desire to do it. Having the schools promote civics. I mean, in my high school, we spent 2 days on local government. Spent all kinds of time learning about Congress and, you know, all the stuff that, you know, it's important. And but it doesn't impact me as directly on a daily basis. I mean, we stop picking up your trash, that'll have meaning in your life. I mean, we don't do it, but we pay waste management. So if Dan stopped paying the bill, that's gonna affect you right away. A lot of things that happen at the federal level may not affect you at all, or may not affect you for quite some time. But we had that much local government. And so the educational system has failed, and their civic responsibility, you know, the Civics Club is making that a big focus. I mean, high school seniors need to leave their school before they graduate. They need to have kind of a basic understanding. I've worked for elected officials that after they won the election didn't know that they were the city manager's boss. Okay. They had no idea. Single issue candidate, didn't know, wasn't prepared. That wouldn't have happened in the 1960s. I mean, you wouldn't get elected to city council unless you were, you probably be on Rotary, had to serve in the United Way, you had to be a leader of your neighborhood, you had to be well known in your church. But all these institutions, I mean, United Way is not on the incline. You know, church attendance, like this, leadership institutions have, there's a lot of public trust that's been broken, and people have become more self-reliant, more selfish, and so the fabric community is going down. So it's just hard, you know, a lot of hard work. You should be telling people how to do it, because you've done it.
Well, it is also interesting, not to take your time, everyone else's, but if you do get engaged, there's a huge negative disincentive to do so. If you get engaged, you find yourself being branded on social media as racist, bigot, you know, all kinds of things.
Yes.
So if you do step out and try and make a difference, you could wind up easily regretting, what did I do this for?
Well, yes, absolutely. We're in the gotcha situation. Is that there are a lot of disincentives. It can hurt if people. It's difficult. It can impact their family. It can impact their jobs. You know, but the idea of somebody's got to do it. You know, America can't exist. But what if nobody wanted to serve in the military? Well, we'd force them to do it. Okay, there's a draft. But by and large, most people volunteer. Thank God, people volunteer to be in the military. Thank God we have city. Yeah.
I just want to add that to address Chuck's question, we invited Sean to the Civics Club, invited him to speak on the trends he's seeing, because he is pretty passionate and has been in that field and that industry and watched those trends changing and shifting. So we invited him to get those insights and that input for those of us who are here today, not to provide an answer to how do you fix it, because I don't think Sean would have that, and those aren't. So that wasn't the intention, and we also asked him to give the updates on some of the neat things like the 311 app and those fantastic things that are happening in the city and how they work and what they do, and those things are directly related to our elected officials and our city government and so those things. So I don't mean to stop that. We know that Sean does not have that answer, and that wasn't what we
People always know the things I don't know. It's very, very apparent.
I would make a comment when you were talking about friends of the Lawrence Park. It's just a small sector of this same type of thing. We have made a difference. We have seen. And the farms is up and running again, and we have 10,000 visitors, and it's just a small thing. But everybody, oh gosh, we were up all up in arms, like you say, because it wasn't going to happen, and things weren't going to happen, and the bison, and we together, it's still an organization, but one sector of what you're talking about, it has made a difference, a big difference.
It certainly has. More questions?
I have a question. Do you have, or does the city have, a social networking strategy? And the reason I say that, having grown up here, I've always been a big Elgin patriot, and I'm very proud of the city. Being a professional, I tend to look at things sometimes with a critical eye.
Sure.
One of the things that I found the most fascinating and interesting and really successful has been actually the Elgin Police's Facebook page. Whoever the admin is, that is very professional, handles a lot of difficult questions and subject matter in a way that I think it's very beneficial for everybody. I would like to see that if the, you know, the fire department could have something, you know, the Explorers program, things like that that we're doing in the community. I had no idea of that before I saw it on the Facebook page. That's actually sparked dialogue in my workplace and with people I know, and it's just, I think, a great resource. So,
the police department has certainly pioneered us in that area, and police departments are different. I mean, there's a very specific, you know, public safety obviously is going to be the most important. We don't want all the other departments to have their own, because that's the idea of separate business units.
Right.
But we do have a strategy. It's actually being employed. Both Laura and Dan could talk to you more about it after the meeting. And it's been a very positive thing, but as much as the chief would tell you, the one downside, and again, it's been way more positive than negative, is that we have found there's been a tendency that Facebook feels a lot bigger than it is.
Sure.
And so, I got off Facebook a year ago because I found it to be becoming increasingly negative. And when you consume negative information, it has an impact on you. And and so minority viewpoints or very disparate kind of opinions can be amplified. And so we've had to fight that. But when it comes to communicating with the public, it's been, you know, absolutely amazing. And so it's just making sure that for all of our strategies, and this is incredibly important to the city council, because to a person, every city council member, they care immensely about what the public thinks. And whenever I hear opinions to the contrary, I'm like, well, I'm with them all day, every day, so I know they do. It can be very, very helpful. And we just want to make sure that we have more positive experiences and not too many, you know, parking space, you know, which again dominated the resources of the city and a lot of money. There was thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars in staff time.